Hello there, COP. Welcome to our weekend service online. Thank you for joining. Thank you for giving your priority to the Lord and for in this way joining to worship God. And it's going to be a great service with great teaching from Pastor. We always start our online services with Psalm 91. I'm going to read it to you today from the NIV 84. It says, "He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. If you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord who is my refuge, then no harm will befall you, no disaster will come near your tent. For He will command His angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because He loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation." COP, we have gathered to honor the Lord, to acknowledge Him, as it says, "I will protect Him, for He acknowledges my name." By gathering together today, that is exactly what we are doing. We are acknowledging His name, His lordship over our lives. And it is a privilege and an honor for us to worship the Lord. So that's what we are going to do right now. So gather your family and let's focus our eyes and our hearts on the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And let's acknowledge His name, His greatness, as we worship Him together.
Thank you. Well, we got some good news. We're under MECQ. And we got some not so good news. We're still limited to drive-in and Fortress 91. So, congregation, but let me ask you to do something for me. Make sure that you get to a drive-in service this weekend, or you get to a Fortress 91 this weekend or during the week next week. And make sure you take home some extra communion emblems. Now, not for the barangay, all right, but for the family. Make sure you keep them in the refrigerator because it's pure Welch's grape juice, all right? And next Saturday and Sunday, not this Saturday and Sunday, but next Saturday and Sunday, we're going to have communion together online. And we're going to celebrate what Jesus did for us. So make sure you're in drive-in, or make sure you come by a Fortress 91 this week. Do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together. Do not forsake the house of God. Amen? All right. I want to teach you for our offering thought today. We've interrupted our series on retainable and promotable. We'll do that when we get back out of lockdown because those take longer. And I want to continue with the prayer of Jabez. This was a man that got labeled as one who brings pain. And instead, he turned around and he was a man of gravitas. He was a man of substance and significance. He was a man of accomplishment. And I taught you last week, it doesn't matter how people label you, and they'll put all kinds of ugly labels on you in life, out of jealousy, out of envy, out of resentment because you have what they don't have, whatever. They'll put labels on you, but those labels don't define you. You will be remembered for your accomplishments. So just go bear fruit and don't worry about what people label you. I want to take it on from there today into his prayer. 1 Chronicles 4:10. Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, "Oh, that you would bless me and enlarge my border, and that your hand might be with me, and that you would keep me from harm so that it might not bring me pain." He said, "Listen, I've been through enough in life, Lord. I have four things to ask of you." Now, the first one is a really big general one. He said, "Oh, that you would bless me." Now, when we begin to understand the purpose of blessings, and this is far bigger than an offering thought or even a sermon. This would be an entire series. We have to understand the need for God's blessing in our lives. When Adam and Eve sinned, there was a curse that came upon the earth. Genesis chapter 3, beginning with verse 17. "And to Adam he said, 'Because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree of which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it, because you touched what was mine. Cursed is the ground because of you, and in pain you shall eat all the days of your life.'" Now, the Hebrew word there for pain means toil, hardship, painful work. We have to recognize that this curse affected the livelihood of everyone that would follow after Adam, all of us even to this day. Life was easier before sin came into the world. Now, all of creation came under a curse, and God said, "In pain, in painful toil and hard work, you shall eat of it all the days of your life." Now remember the people of Israel. While they were in Egypt in the land of Goshen, they had to water the land like a garden. They had to carry the water from the river and water the garden. But God told them, and I taught you this in detail, God told them, when you enter the promised land, it's not going to be like that. God puts rain upon the land. God says, "I'm going to bless the land, and I'm going to bless you, and I'm going to make life easier." Now, the blessings of God, that's what it does. It removes the curse off of this creation. It makes things easier. Only the blessing of God can remove the effects of the curse of God. Let me say that again. Only the blessings of God upon your life can remove the curse of God upon this creation and the painful toil that it causes. Now look at the benefits of this blessing. Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 4. "But there shall be no poor among you, for the Lord will bless you in the land the Lord your God has given you for an inheritance to possess." Now notice, bless you in the land he's given you. The promise, the destiny, the inheritance that God had for them, God's plan for their life as a people and as a nation. Now, here's the truth of this. God will bless you. God will bless his will for your life. He won't bless your will for your life. He won't bless your plan for your life. He won't bless, you know, your friend's plan for your life. But God will bless his plan for your life. This is why some of you, you've been so successful in one company, but one day somebody gave you a better offer and you got over to the other company and it just fell apart because you weren't in God's will anymore. God planted you in that other place. God put you in that other place. That was your promised land. And God blesses you in the promises that he has made to you. Secondly, when God blesses us, it brings prosperity. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 22, the blessing of the Lord maketh rich, and he adds no sorrow to it. Now, people may try to add sorrow to it, but God will add no sorrow to it. The illustration of Abraham, Genesis 24, verse 35, Abraham's servant says, the Lord has greatly blessed my master, and he has become great. He has given him flocks and herds, silver and gold, male servants, female servants, camels and donkeys. He's made my master great, and he's greatly blessed him. Genesis chapter 26, verse 14, and Isaac sowed in that land and reaped the same year a hundredfold. The Lord blessed him, and the man became rich and gained more and more until he became very wealthy. Now this blessing affects everything that you do. Remember, this world will not release its prosperity to us except through painful toil. But then God comes along and God says, I'm going to bless you. No wonder the scripture says he blesses the work of our hands, as we'll get to in just a moment. Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 6. For the Lord your God will bless you as he promised you, and you will lend to many nations, but you shall not borrow, and you shall rule over many nations, but they shall not rule over you. So, all right, the blessings of God brings prosperity and wealth as we are living in the promises that he made to us, living where he planted us. Secondly, his blessing brings prosperity. Thirdly, his blessing, forgive me, gives us a great name. Genesis 12, 1 and 2. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land I will show you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great. We don't have to strive for greatness in this world. All we have to do is be blessed of the Lord. When God blesses us, he makes our name great so that you will be a blessing. We are blessed to be a blessing. Let me say that again. We are blessed to be a blessing. Now think, we read it last week in devotions. Think about Job's life. In Job chapter 1, verse 3, there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And he was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. And there were born to him 7 sons and 3 daughters. He possessed 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, and very many servants. So that this man was the greatest of all the people of the East. Now, that's the blessings of God. Now, you say, well, Pastor Sumrall, Satan destroyed his prosperity. Yes, but God restored twofold. Now, if he was already the greatest man of all the people of the East, and then Satan wiped out what he had, and God restored twofold, he is twice the greatest of all the people of the East. That's the blessings of God. I already taught you Deuteronomy 2, verse 7. For the Lord your God has blessed you in all the work of your hands. Now, again, remember, this earth will not yield its fruit to us except through painful toil. Now, God says, I'm going to bless the work of your hands. Blessings are going to flow to the work of your hands. Now, again, notice, this can't be delegated to other people. The blessing on the work of your hands cannot be delegated to other people. This is why you can never allow yourself to get in a position where you sit back and you allow everybody else to do the work and you don't do the work. Because the blessing is not on their hands. The blessing is on your hands. And this is one of the things I try to teach business people, especially family business people. You know, you can't just delegate everything to everybody. You've got to stay involved because the blessing flows through the work of your hands. This earth is still cursed. This earth will still only yield its fruit and blessing and prosperity to us through painful toil. So don't think that, you know, just anybody can do what you're doing. As a believer, there is a blessing on the work of your hands. So don't delegate everything. Stay very much involved because the blessing flows through the work of your hands. It doesn't just, okay, God says, I'm going to bless them. You know, yes, but the blessing flows through the work of your hands. The blessing brings multiplication. Genesis 28, verse 3, God Almighty bless you and make you fruitful and multiply you. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 13, he will love you, bless you, and multiply you. Hebrews 6, verse 14, saying, surely I will bless you and multiply you. Psalms 107, verse 38, by his blessing they will multiply greatly. Multiply your business. Multiply the locations of your business. Multiply your connect group. Multiplication flows from the blessings of God. Now, sometimes I teach young pastors, you know, you can't do this in your own ability. You can't grow a church. You can't grow a connect group. And businessmen, you can't grow a business. And professionals, you can't grow a career in your own strength and ability. It takes the blessings of God. Now, let me give you one more, and I'll close with this one. This is fun. 2 Chronicles 31, verses 3 to 10. The contribution of the king from his own possession was for the burnt offerings of morning and evening, and the burnt offerings for the Sabbaths, the new moons, and appointed feasts, as it is written in the law of the Lord. And he commanded the people who lived in Jerusalem to give the portion due the priests and the Levites, that they might give themselves to the law of the Lord. As soon as the command was spread abroad, the people of Israel gave in abundance the first fruits of grain, wine, oil, honey, and all the produce of the field, and they brought in abundantly the tithe of everything. So, all right, revival hits. The people begin to return to God and bring abundant offerings and bring the tithe in abundance. Now, notice what happens to the work of God. And the people of Israel, verse 6, and Judah, who lived in the cities of Judah, also brought in the tithe of the cattle and the sheep, but the tithe of the dedicated things that had been dedicated to the Lord their God, and laid them in heaps. In the third month, they began to pile up the heaps and finished them on the seventh month. And when Hezekiah and the princes came and saw the heaps, they blessed the Lord and the people of Israel. Hezekiah questioned the priests and Levites about the heaps, the big piles of blessings. And Azariah, the chief priest, who was of the house of Zadok, answered him, since they began to bring the contributions into the house of the Lord, we have eaten and had enough and have plenty left. For the Lord has blessed his people so that we have this large amount left. Now notice, when God blesses his people and the people are faithful to God with their tithe and their offerings, there is abundance in the house of God. But the only way there can be abundance in the house of God, notice, for the Lord has blessed his people so that we have this large amount left. The only reason we can have an abundance in God's house, remember how he said, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, okay? The only reason we can have an abundance in God's house is because God has blessed his people. Now, brothers and sisters, this is the root of prosperity in the work of God. Now, you need to get a hold of this, because everybody always wants to tell you strange things about raising money and how to raise money and how to get more offerings and how to do this and how to do that and raising money online. No. The way for there to be an abundance in God's house is for God to bless his people. That's it. That's it. That's how there's an abundance in God's house, as God blesses and prospers his people. So I teach young pastors, listen, don't read more books on how to raise money, and don't figure out ways to get money out of people, and don't reach for the money. Don't do any of these things people teach you to do today. You just work on bringing the people into a good relationship with God. You get them serving God. You get them obeying God. You get them under the blessings of God. You get them into a place where God is bringing his blessings upon their lives and their families. And I said, you know what? When the people are blessed, the work of God has abundance. All right, I'm going to stop there today. Beloved, we're so thankful to God for how he's provided for all of our families during this time. I know that there are some of our families that have been struggling, and you know what? We've been working really hard to get food out to those families. And I have to be honest with you, I've been very humbled. The branch churches in Sydney and the branch churches in Los Angeles have sent beautiful donations over and said, please use this to buy food to help our members in Manila. And it was designated to help the members with food. We've never had churches do that for us before. And then our church in Dubai and Abu Dhabi, they sent over 500,000 pesos and said, please make sure that the students finish their schooling, the families that don't have money to pay tuition. So we picked out 13 young people now. 13 young people. I think maybe more than that, but we got over 13 young people now, and we're paying their tuition fees because our members in Dubai wanted to make sure that they helped our people. You know, when you're generous, the Bible says, the generous man will himself be well watered. COP, you've been generous and helped people around the world. And now some of you have been in a struggle, and people around the world are helping you. God is good, and his mercy endures forever. Amen? All right. Now, you can put your tithe in the red envelopes, put your seed in the blue envelopes, and then just stick them inside your Bible or stick them inside a little drawer at the house. And when we get back together in services, or when you come to Fortress 91 or you come to a drive-in service, you bring the tithe and you bring the offerings to God. We don't treat God like Morocco, like a bill to be paid. It's an act of worship. It's an act of honor. All right, let's open up our hearts and worship the Lord again.
You're mine.
week at COP. Our wonderful and faithful CAD, that's our musicians, singers, and dancers, held their August GA with all the joy of being together, celebrating the goodness of God in our ministries and outreaches. This week at COP, we held our virtual COP Abeka facilitated homeschool, moving up, and graduation day. The K-5 students proudly presented what they have learned, with Pastora Betty sharing an inspirational message for the grade 12 students, class of 2021, and joined by class of 2020. Abeka is gratified to say these young people are still very active in their respective ministries. Cynthia de Guzman and John Plama delivered commencement addresses, and Sister Bev, that's me, shared the Word of God for the occasion. The graduating class presented a song of their own composition. For more information about Abeka, please contact Teacher Donna. This week at COP, our Mighty Men in Uniform rejoiced for 133 policemen that gave their hearts to the Lord during their seminar and online schooling. Truly, our MMU are taking every opportunity to share the gospel every day. This week at COP, we praise God with Fidel and Gazelle Morales of Cavite City as they dedicated not one, but two vehicles to the Lord. COP, remember, at any time and in any situation, our pastors are there to serve you. Don't hesitate to call with your prayer requests or urgent situations. We love you and are blessed to serve God alongside you. Likewise, stay tuned to Pastor Sumrall's morning devotions for all the latest announcements and updates. It has been another great week at COP.
Well, we're under MECQ, which means it's going to be easier for you to move around and do drive-in services, and it's going to be easier for you to do Fortress 91. And I really want to encourage all of you to come and be a part of Fortress 91 and take some extra communions home for your family, not for the whole barangay, but for your family. And then next Saturday and Sunday, I want to have a whole church-wide communion together again. We haven't done this for a while. Come Fortress 91, pick up the extra communion, or if you come to one of the drive-in services, tell the ushers I need to take some extra communion home. But now please remember, we make these ourselves every week. This is fresh Welch's grape juice. Do not leave it out. Keep it in the refrigerator so it'll stay good. All right? All right. I want us to get into our material today on God helps his people. We started last week with this, Psalms 121, verses 1 and 2. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. We've been learning together that Jesus teaches us in Mark chapter 4, verse 24 and 25. He said, pay attention to what you hear. With the measure you use, it will be measured to you, and still more will be added to you. For to the one who has, more will be given, and from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away from him. So Jesus basically teaches us that when it comes to scriptural truth, if you don't use it, you lose it. Now, in these days of COVID-19, we don't throw away what we believe. We live what we believe. We don't throw away what we believe about healing. We live what we believe about healing. No, we're not weird and anti-vaxxers and anti-maskers. We're not weird, but we live what we believe. We're not afraid of sickness and disease. Jesus is our healer. We're not afraid of financial catastrophe and crisis because God will provide. The provider is with us. So these are times that we don't throw out what we believe. We choose to live what we believe. These are days that we choose to fight the good fight of faith and not allow the faith of the Word of God that's been planted within our heart to be destroyed by the cares of life. Now, we went on from there and we began to talk about cynicism, an ancient Greek philosophy that entered into the church. It's part of what Paul refers to when he says those dogs. It's part of what Paul refers to in Colossians when he talks about twice don't practice asceticism. You see, Paul understood that there were different challenges in the Gentile church than there were in the Jewish church. In the Hellenistic church, The church touched by the Greek culture, the church born within the Greek culture, they had a lot of, forgive me, doctrines of demons, just like the Jews had their doctrines of demons.
And one of these false doctrines that was very strong was cynicism. Paul calls them dogs. He refers to asceticism, the destruction of the human body, the putting down of the human body. So Paul had to write to the church of Colossae, and he had to write to the church of Ephesus that as the season began to change from revival into some difficult years for the seven churches of Asia, he had to write to them, hey, Timothy, remind the people God gave us all things to enjoy. God gives us all things richly to enjoy. Don't practice asceticism. Don't fall for this teaching by these dogs, these guys that are always putting down the human body and teaching poverty. He said, listen, you need to get over that. So we've gone through and we've studied the fact that God does provide. That in days like this, this doctrine of demons, of poverty mentality really wants to emerge and push itself into the church because it makes us feel good that, okay, we should be poor and we are poor, so we should be poor, so that's a good thing, rather than challenging us to change our circumstances by our faith, by what we believe in God, that God will provide. But we also said that cynicism brings in this, you're alone in this, that you can't count on anybody and you can't count on God. And so we've taken a few weeks and we've learned that we are not alone in this circumstance. God has promised that he sees. God has promised that he knows. God has promised that he will never leave us or forsake us. And last week we focused on, you're not alone in these circumstances. God will help you. Now I want to pick up from there and begin to talk about the fruit of God's help. You know, there are many people that offer to help us in life, and forgive me, but sometimes they do more harm than good. And sometimes people who want to help us, they really have a good heart, but they don't have ability to go with it. And so, honestly, it's easier to do it ourselves. Many times in life, we've asked people to help us, and forgive me, it wasn't much help. I can think of a young man who I asked to help me many, many years ago when I was working as a mechanic. Now, I don't understand the new cars with the plug your cell phone in and read all the computers, but the old cars, the 1960s, the 1970s, those are the cars that I worked on, and I understand. And I was pulling the transmission out of a car, and I asked a friend to help me because it really is a two-man job. You've got to have one guy with the winch and everything pulling the engine one direction, and then you pull the transmission from underneath the other direction. And so I asked him to help me, and before long, it was pretty obvious he didn't know what he was doing. I said, have you ever done this before? He said, no. I said, have you ever worked on cars before? He said, no. And I was on this little wooden trolley underneath the car, and I just kind of slid myself out, and I thought, you know, I'm not going to get a transmission in my face because some guy doesn't know what he's doing. I better get somebody to help me who knows what he's doing. In the same way, there are many times that we need help in life, and we have to learn who to ask for help. When God helps you, he knows what he's doing. When God helps you, he has the ability to do what needs to be done. Now, let me begin to walk you through some things that happens. First of all, when God helps us, he brings change into our present circumstances as well as our future circumstances. Now, let's talk about present change, all right? He brings change. We sing the song, when he walks into the room, everything changes. Well, what changes? When God steps into a situation, what changes in our present circumstances? Well, first of all, he brings deliverance. Psalms 37, verse 40. The Lord helps them and delivers them. He delivers them from the wicked and saves them because they take refuge in him. So he said, all right, help brings deliverance. Exodus chapter 3, verses 7 to 8, a verse we've used a lot lately. Then the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in the desert. And I have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their sufferings. Notice, I've seen, I've heard, I know. And now verse 8, and I have come down to deliver them. When God steps into a situation to help you, beloved, he doesn't leave the situation the same. He brings deliverance. God doesn't walk into a difficult situation of our life and say, well, I tried, and then walks away. God doesn't walk into a situation in our life and say, well, I did my best and walk away. People may do that. But when God steps into a situation to help, God brings deliverance. Now, that deliverance may be healing. Psalms chapter 30, verse 2. O Lord my God, I cried to you for help, and you have healed me. Now that deliverance might be healing. You might be listening to me right now and your lungs are all congested and you're concerned about maybe do I have to go to the hospital, and you don't want to go to the hospital. When you cry to the Lord for help, He will deliver you. He will bring healing. He delivers you from COVID-19. He is the healer. Jesus died on that cross to carry away your sicknesses, your pains, and your diseases. Isaiah chapter 53. When He steps in, He brings healing. Now that healing might be a miracle, which is instant, or that healing may be a healing, and all of a sudden, recovery begins. There's different types of healing in the Bible. For some of us, when God heals us, it's instant. For some of us, there are times when He heals us where all of a sudden you know, He's touched me. And from that day forward, the power of that thing is broken in your life. Strength begins to flow into your life. Life begins to flow into you. Healing begins to flow into you. And you recover. The sick shall recover, as the scripture says. Sometimes this deliverance, when you need help, is salvation. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 6, verses 1 and 2, working together with Him, then we appeal to you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For He says, in a favorable time I listened to you, and in the day of salvation I have helped you. Behold, now is the favorable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. For some of you, the deliverance you need is salvation. Sin is destroying your life. Now, please, I don't want to condemn anybody or make anybody feel bad or hurt anybody's feeling, but straight up, I mean, some of you, forgive me, you've lived a sinful life. And, you know, you hear us talk about prayer and you hear us talk about the reality of God, and you've never experienced that. For you, crying out to God will bring deliverance from the power of sin. All of a sudden, that sin will be broken over your life and your family's back together. All of a sudden, deliverance of sin hits your life and you're not just forgiven. You're delivered from the power of sin. Alcoholism, drugs, pornography, homosexuality, lesbianism, you know, sexual immorality, they're all the same to God. And when He brings deliverance, He sets you free from the power of sin. All you have to do is ask. Sometimes that deliverance is from wicked people attacking us. Psalms 37, verse 40. The Lord helps them and delivers them. He delivers them from the wicked and saves them because they take refuge in Him. Beloved, right now, people are desperate. I mean, please, we have to understand, all over the world, economies are shattering. Companies are closing. People are losing their jobs. And, you know, there's a difference between us and the people of this world. I've been teaching you out of Ephesians. Paul said, listen, we were without hope and without God in this world, but not anymore. The big difference between me and you and the unsaved of the world is we have hope and we have a God who helps us in this world. But the world does not. They really are on their own. And so desperate people do desperate things. And people will attack you. They're attacking your business to try to steal business from you because they're desperate for business. They attack you in your professions and your companies because they want to get you fired to give themselves a little bit more job security. I mean, there's horrible things that are happening, people doing to each other right now, all over the world, in the middle of this COVID-19 thing. And you can't get mad at people about it. It's just human nature. But you have to understand God will help you. God will deliver you from the wicked. From the attacks of the wicked, God will deliver you. Now, not only does God change the situation, God changes us on the insides in the middle of a situation. Now, again, remember, people who have no hope, they attack. But we're not like that. Not only does God change our situation, our circumstances, God changes us. Now, let me show this to you. Psalms chapter 46, verse 5. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. Okay? When God is in the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God will help her when the morning dawns. Romans 14, verse 4. Who are you to pass judgment on the servant of another? It is before his own master that he stands or falls. And he will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make him stand. Now remember all the teaching I did for months and months and months about standing and standing firm. And God is able to make you stand. And put that together then with Psalms 46:5. God is in the midst of her. God's with her. She shall not be moved. God will help her. When God begins to help you, one of the things he changes is our hearts. And that desire to quit, that desire to roll over and give up, that goes away. And an attitude of determination begins to flow within your heart. Now some of you have been through this. You were ready to quit. You got tired of being harassed in your office. You got tired of these people abusing you in the office, trying to force you out because they wanted job security for themselves, because they wanted to force you out because they wanted their friend to have your job. You've been through this, that it would have been so easy to just roll over and say, I give up, I quit. I'm just done with this. I'm done. I'm out of here. But you see, when God helps you, he doesn't just change the circumstances. He changes our hearts. And we're not movable anymore. God makes us stand. Determination replaces a quitter attitude. Now, look at this in the life of the Apostle Paul. Acts 14, verses 1 to 3. Now, at Iconium, they entered together into a Jewish synagogue and spoke in such a way that a great number of both Jews and Greeks believed. But the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their minds against the brothers. So what did Paul do? Quit? You know, they've lied about me. They've said all kinds of horrible things. They've accused me of all kinds of things. People don't want to listen to me because of the lies that have been told about me. Do you know what Paul did? Scripture said, verse 3, so he remained there a long time, speaking boldly for the Lord. I like that. When God helped him, God took the quitter out of him and put in a holy determination to stand his ground and be unmovable. Think about Paul in Corinth. Paul had been through a lot when he got to Corinth. I mean, please remember with me our studies in Acts. Think about what Paul went through. He left his home church in Antioch of Syria, where he was greatly loved. He went back up through the Galatian Peninsula on that second tour and strengthened all the churches there and delivered the letter showing salvation by grace. And then he was about to head home, and the Spirit begins to nudge him to keep moving. He doesn't have enough money, but he keeps moving. He obeys God, and God will provide. He gets to Troas. He has the Macedonian vision. He crosses the Aegean Sea. He passes right through Neapolis because it's not in Macedonia. He stops at the first city in Macedonia, a city called Philippi. He's put in jail, and not just any jail. Remember, he's put in the inner dungeon where he is chained to the floor. And they don't feed people in there. You are chained in there to die. And the rats eat you. I mean, they're bringing the rats lunch. And God delivered him. He goes on to Thessalonica. He gets thrown out of Thessalonica by persecution. He goes on to Berea. He gets thrown out of Berea by persecution. He has to escape, and he goes by himself to the city of Athens to wait for some of the other brethren to catch up. He has nothing to do in Athens. He does a little bit of ministry. Finally, he walks 2 days across the peninsula to get to the city of Corinth. And when he gets there, he's broken physically and he's broken financially. And he has to get a job to support himself. He goes in and begins to preach in the synagogue. He has a great harvest of souls. And what happens? Persecution begins again. And God speaks to him and says, don't leave here. Don't leave here. I'm going to help you. I've got many people in this city. Paul, don't leave here. God took the quit even out of the heart of the Apostle Paul. Now, please forgive me. Some of you are about ready to roll over and quit. You're going to quit that job even though you don't have another job. Some of you young pastors listening to me across the country, you're about to quit your church because you say, I just can't keep going. It's impossible. No, it is not impossible. With God, all things are possible. Now, beloved, you just got to let God help you. God will take the quit out of you, and God will put determination in you. Whatever people say to you, whatever people do to you, whatever circumstances come, you are determined to finish the goal. Some of you are ready to quit your dreams, quit that dream house, quit starting that family business. you're about ready to quit that degree. You wanted to become a doctor. Now you're going to just settle for being, you know, a graduate in nursing. You're quitting on your dreams. Let God help you. And God will put the determination back in your heart, just like he did the Apostle Paul. God will put the determination back in your heart, just like Paul. And rather than be a quitter, you're going to be a very determined person. When God helps you, you're no longer disgraced and shamed. Isaiah chapter 50, verses 7 to 9. But the Lord helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like a flint, and I know I shall not be put to shame. One of the messianic prophecies, one of the prophecies of Jesus. But I want you to notice that God helps me. Therefore, I will not be disgraced. Some of you, forgive me, you're afraid of the shame. You're afraid of the shame. Don't be afraid of the shame. Jesus wasn't afraid of the shame. Don't be afraid of the shame. God will help you. Well, Pastor, what happens if I can't make payroll? God will help you. What happens if I can't pay my Meralco? God will help you. Don't quit and run away because of the shame. I've been your pastor for over 40 years, and one of the hardest things I've seen is people making wrong decisions because they didn't want to face embarrassment, because they didn't want to face shame. God will help you, beloved. Don't be afraid to face the shame. Jesus was not afraid to face the shame. Despising the shame, he still went to the cross. Don't be afraid to face the shame and disgrace. God will help you. But now there's another one, and I don't know where else to put it in this 25 pages of notes I've gotten on all this material. So please let me stick it here. Not only does God help us on the insides in our present circumstances, and not only does he change our present circumstances, but when God helps us, he brings life. And by that I mean real physical life. Genesis chapter 4, verse 1. Now Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord. Now, some of you are afraid. You put your life on hold. You haven't gotten pregnant yet. You're afraid to get pregnant because of COVID-19. You're afraid for the baby. You're afraid for your own physical health. You're concerned, and you're just, well, maybe I'm going to get too old to have babies now. Excuse me. With God's help, you will conceive. With God's help, you will give birth to a strong, healthy baby. With God's help, you will be kept safe in childbirth. With the help of God, God changes the circumstances. With the help of God, he changes us on the inside. With the help of God, he even gives us babies. But not only does God change the present, I said God also changes the future. 1 Chronicles chapter 15, 1 Chronicles chapter 15, beginning with verse 26. And because God helped the Levites who were carrying the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, they sacrificed 7 bulls and 7 rams. And David was also clothed with a robe of fine linen, and also all the Levites who were carrying the Ark and the singers, and Joanna, the leader of the music of the singers, and David wore a linen ephod. Now, notice, God helped the Levites who were carrying the Ark. The first thing I want you to see here is because Christian service is our priority. Now, you'll always learn, seek first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, and then all these things will be added unto you. Christian service comes first. We don't give up serving him in the middle of COVID-19. Well, this is a time to survive. No, this is a time to serve, and God will provide. But something that you need to understand about Christian service, sometimes you need God's help just because it's hard physically. Now, we don't think too much about these 4 Levites who would have to carry the ark. The ark was to be carried with 2 poles that went through rings on either side, and it was a long pole, and 4 guys carried it, one on each side in the front, one on each side in the back, and they carried it. Now, we don't think too much about it because, you know, for the most part, they were walking on level ground through the desert. But now it's time to bring the Ark of the Covenant back to Jerusalem. It's been gone for a long time. It was captured, taken down to Dagon's temple. Dagon bowed before it. It was sent back in the ox cart with the golden hemorrhoids and the golden mice, remember? And it was never brought back into the tent of meeting. It was never brought back and you know, put back together with everything else in the Holy of Holies. So finally, it's brought from Kiriath Jearim, and they get as far as the home of Obed-Edom. Obed-Edom's home is about, scholars say, 5 to 7 kilometers down the mountain from Jerusalem. And so now it's time. David is bringing it. He's gotten it from Kiriath Jearim to Obed-Edom's home. You remember the problem because it was being carried on an ox cart, just like it was the last time it was moved by those foreigners. Okay, but now David has figured out how to do things right. He understands there are some rules about how God wants things done, and he does it right. Now the Levites are carrying it the last 5 to 7 kilometers back up the mountain to Jerusalem. But you know what? That thing, remember, was made of gold. It had solid gold on the outside, a layer of wood, and solid gold on the inside. A solid gold mercy seat on top of it with solid gold cherubim above that. Most scholars say that that thing weighed someplace between 80 and 105, maybe 110 kilos. So you're looking at something that's pretty heavy. We say, well, it's 4 men carrying it. Yes, 4 men carrying it uphill. Not nice roads like we have today. Up stony, muddy paths. This is not an easy journey. It'd be like 4 guys trying to carry something that's 100+ kilos in the province across a dike in a rice field. Yeah, that's not too easy. Now make that uphill. So let's say carrying it uphill through the forest, going uphill through the forest to Baguio, not even taking the nice Kenyan road, through the forest. Yeah, that was a hard trek, very hard trek, but God helped them. Now, all that to say this, there are many things that we do in the ministry, in our service of God, that are hard. Not all the time. It wasn't hard to carry the ark on level ground, but there are times that we have to do things going uphill. There are times being an usher is really easy. And then there are seasons like this in COVID-19 where being an usher and showing up and standing in a hot parking lot is hard. There are times setting up the go truck for drive-in service is easy. Nice weather, a little overcast. And there are times when I've watched those men set up that go truck in rain blowing sideways at South Campus. And those men never shirked from their duties. There are times being a connect group leader is easy. And then there are times being a connect group leader is hard. There are times being a choir member is easy, and there are times being a choir member is hard. There are times being a pastor is not too hard physically. And there are times being a pastor is really hard physically. There are times when our service of God physically is difficult for us to do. God will help you. Don't whine, don't complain. God will help you. Just like he helped these Levites carry that thing up the mountain. God will help you. When the physical burden of the ministry, of your Christian service, God will help you. There was a pastor who was texting me from Africa. He'd been in one of the meetings I'd been in over there. And in his church, the government said there are no services. You can only meet 10 people at a time. So he got together his pastors, and he had a few pastors on staff with him. And they started doing 24-hour church, 15 minutes at a time, 10 people at a time. They started having church. And they did this for months. And they were physically exhausted. But they said, we have a responsibility to care for our congregation. Now, I look at a man like that, and I go, I cannot even imagine the crowns and the rewards that God has for a man like that in heaven. I just look at that and go, wow. And I said, you have no curfews. He said, no, we have no curfews. So they took Fortress 91 and took it up about 10 steps because they were determined to care. Because in their place, they don't have internet. They don't have Wi-Fi like we do. I mean, it's a difficult situation. People have cell phones, but there's not too many computers. And Wi-Fi is almost non-existent. They can't do some of the things that we can do. And this pastor was determined. Now, normally, he only preached one service a week. Now they were doing 24 hours a day, 7 days a week services. I double salute a man who was determined to fulfill his duties as a pastor in caring for the sheep. Paul recognized that there are times opposition to the ministry requires God's help. In Philippians chapter 1, beginning with verse 12, brothers, I want you to know that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel, being put in jail. He said, all things work together for good, folks. So that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. He said, you know, they saw what I've gone through and they realize Paul can do it, we can do it too. If the old man can go through this, we young men can do it too. He said, yes, some indeed preach Christ out of envy and rivalry. Paul said, please, I understand. I understand there are bad preachers out there who preach from envy and rivalry. He said, but others from goodwill. He said, don't forget the good pastors, all right? You see the jerk pastors. Don't forget the good pastors. The latter do it out of love. He said, these people that do it from goodwill, they preach the gospel out of love. And they know that I've been put here. What's happening to me is for the defense of the gospel. He said, the former, these guys that preach out of envy and rivalry, he said, they proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition. He said, you know, their motives are all wrong. Not sincerely. He said, there's no sincerity there. They have the right words. They say the right words, but their motives are wrong and there's no sincerity. He said, thinking to afflict me in my imprisonment. He said, they just want to poke their finger in my eye. He said, they just want to torment me. They just want to make my life even more difficult in this imprisonment. He said, I get this. I understand this. He said, what then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense, he said, whether they're just faking it, or in truth, sincerity, Christ is proclaimed. Paul said, I don't care whether people are pretending or whether they're sincere. He said, Christ is proclaimed. And in that I rejoice. And yes, I will rejoice. Now listen to Paul here. See, Paul realizes that even when somebody stands up and preaches out of rivalry and envy and without sincerity and just seeking to attack Paul personally, Paul said, I'm just happy that Jesus has preached. Because remember, the power is in the message, not in the messenger. He said, for I know, verse 19, that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance. He said, the help of the Holy Spirit. He said, this is going to be all right. There are many things, there are many, many things that happen in our life from people who are not sincere. But if you keep your focus on Jesus, you keep your focus on the goal. You see, Paul's ultimate goal was for the name of Jesus to be known. Paul's ultimate goal was for the gospel to be preached. And if people want to attack him while they're doing it, that's okay. At least Jesus is preached. Keep your eyes on the goal. God will help you. But now our future is changed. Nehemiah 6, verse 16. And when all our enemies heard of it, all the nations around us were afraid and fell greatly in their self-esteem. They were discouraged and demoralized. For they perceived that this work had been accomplished with the help of our God. When God helps you, your enemies are demoralized. When God helps you, they have to back up and realize, you know what? God's with this guy and God's helping him. Now, some of you need to realize that in your offices and in your businesses. because there's a lot of attack happening right now. There's a lot of things going on right now. There's a lot of businesses being attacked right now because other businesses are trying to survive. There's a lot of careers being attacked right now because other people are trying to survive. I was told the story even of a canteen in a neighborhood. Some rivals are trying to sow lies and tell everybody that there's food poisoning over there and that they're not, there's cockroaches in the soup and, you know, all the typical lies about canteens, trying to destroy the business of this one nanai. But you know what? When you keep going, God will help you. And when God helps you, these people look at you and go, you know what? We did our best to destroy them. But obviously God is with them and God is helping them. And they're demoralized. These people who want to destroy you, God is going to do miracles to help you. Every one of us in life have these Sanballats and Tobias from Nehemiah. Every one of us has Sanballats and Tobias that try to stop and destroy us from reaching the goals that God has given us in our lives. But you don't give up. You trust God to help you. You stand back and trust God to help you and refuse to quit. You let God begin to work. You finish the goal. You finish the project. And people turn around and go, you know what? God is obviously with this person. A second thing that happens, your fame spreads. 2 Chronicles chapter 26, verse 15. In Jerusalem, King Uzziah made machines invented by skillful men to be on the towers and the corners to shoot arrows and great stones. And his fame spread far, for he was marvelously helped till he was strong. Now, yes, we learned in our devotions that he got proud and fell. But I want you to notice God brought him people, skillful people, and they invented machines. Machines of war, machines that could sit on the towers and shoot multiple arrows and shoot great stones and defend the city of Jerusalem. Creativity, inventiveness, witty inventions, as the King James says. God did this. That's how God helped him, and his fame spread. Now, beloved, we live in a turning point in world history. And you need to understand that. We're not going back to old normal. I mean, the world is never going to be the same that it was before. Forgive me. Now, do you try to live in the past, or do you let God help you with new creative ideas? Do you, in your company, hire people who are clever and who know how to come up with new ideas? Or do you stick with the old guys who just don't know how to do anything and they just want to ride out their careers? Some of you businessmen have decisions to make. Do you want to just ride out your career to the end of your life? Do you want to just ride out your family business to the end of your life? Or do you want to surround yourself with people who have clever ideas and then work with these people to build these clever projects, these clever platforms, these clever things? You see, if you want to live in yesterday, you're never going to be successful. Uzziah was a man who would live in tomorrow. He let God give him witty inventions, and his fame spread. Whether it's ministry, whether it's business, whether it's your career, it's time to begin to open up your heart and let God help you by showing you new ways of doing things and giving you a heart to listen to people that have new ideas. It's one of the biggest destructivenesses of family businesses. I've watched it as your pastor for over 40 years. And I've sat people down and I said, listen, you can't keep doing things the way you used to do them. You've got to progress. You've got to move forward. Well, no, no. Folks, it's too easy to live in yesterday. Uzziah did not live in yesterday. Uzziah let God help him to build the future. Let me give you one more. And I'll close with this one. 1 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 18. One of the ways God helps you is to bring you successful people that you can build a future with. Now listen to me carefully, especially you business owners. We know that God prunes us before he brings blessing. Every time in the scripture before the latter rain, that's when the pruning of the vineyards took place. When God prunes, he's about to bring great blessing. There are times that God prunes things from our life. He prunes time-consuming things from our life. He prunes people from our life. People that are just consuming resources and not bringing productivity. You see, you prune these new little shoots that are coming out that consume all the resources of the latter rain. And you prune it so that all the resources go into the productivity, the swelling of the fruit and making the grapes full and tasty. That's what the purpose of pruning is. Now, we know that God does the pruning. Before God brings great blessing, God does a pruning. So all the resources go into productivity. But we also need to understand that when God helps us, he brings us people to build a future with. 1 Chronicles 12:18, then the Spirit clothed Amasiah, chief of the 30. And he said, we are yours, O David, and with you, O son of Jesse, peace. Peace to you and peace to your helpers, for your God helps you. Then David received them and made them officers of his troops. Now notice, these 30 became a permanent part of David's life. They were in every battle and every war that David fought. They were his most trusted warriors. There came a point when God helped him by bringing very successful people that would be permanent and loyal to David, and that David could use to build a future with. Now, some of you businessmen need to understand that in these days, God is going to bring men of the 30. He's going to bring very successful people that will be loyal to you. Don't think of all the disloyalties of the past. He's going to bring people to you that will be very loyal and will attach themselves to you because they see God helping you. They recognize this is done with the hand of God. They see God helping you. And that's where the loyalty comes from. The loyalty doesn't come from the paycheck. The loyalty comes from the fact that they see God helping you. And these are people you can build a new future with. I'm going to stop there for now, and we're going to pick up again next week and continue to dig more into this. But I want you to learn to let God help you. I want you to learn to get up every morning and say, Lord, I need your help today. That when you face big obstacles, you come to God like we taught you a couple of Friday nights ago, and you ask God for help. Father, I ask for humbleness in each of our hearts. I ask for a humility to ask for help, to never try to do things on our own, to never lean upon the proverbial arm of flesh. But Father, let there be a desire in each of our hearts to always look to you for help. Our help comes from the Lord. Father, let our hearts cry out to you every morning. Let our hearts cry out to you with every big obstacle and every big challenge we face. And Lord, thank you for your help. And thank you for making your help so obvious to everybody around us. Lord, we want you to have all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Remember, all through this week, we'll have Fortress 91 in all of our campuses, except on Monday. Monday, we really want the pastors to rest. But Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, Fortress 91. We'll have drive-in services again next weekend. We have morning devotions with you every morning at 6. We have evening service every night at 7. We have our seniors program and our destination for the teens, and we have our youth services. We've got so much happening online. Please be a part of it. Because we want to keep putting faith. Faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word. We want to keep pouring faith into your heart in these days. In Jesus' name.